Greetings to all of you in the sweet and precious name of Jesus. I'm sorry I will not be able to speak to you in Malayalam. I can understand Malayalam and I can speak to some extent, but I don't think I can give a full message in Malayalam. But I thank and praise God for giving me this opportunity to be with you and to share God's word. Shall we just close our eyes for a minute? இன்னியோளும் என்னை நடத்தி இன்னியோளும் என்னை புலர்த்தி
conference, we have the great privilege of meditating on the words of Joshua. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And God has given us this great privilege to stand and to sit and to pray in the presence of God, remembering these words over and over again, so that as we leave this hall, as we leave this place, these words will be always ringing in our ears. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And as I share with you this morning, I want to share from the life of Joshua himself as to why Joshua would have brought out this tremendous statement. Dearly beloved children of God, Joshua was a very successful man. I would like the verses to be projected on the screen. I have given the CD to the people there concerned. Kindly put it on the screen. Joshua was a very successful man. And at the end of his career, he brings out this tremendous mission statement saying, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." He was a very successful man. In this world today, success has got many meanings. When people say they are successful, it implies amassing a lot of wealth or coming into power or holding great positions or having life's pleasures and desires fulfilled. Then people say we are successful. But in the word of God, that is not real success. When the desire in the heart of God for you and I is fulfilled, when heaven's desire for us is fulfilled, When the will of God is fulfilled in us, that is real success. Hallelujah. In this world, whether we receive whatever we desire, whether we have the pleasures of this world, whether we have a very smooth life or not, it really doesn't matter. But when the heart of God for us is fulfilled in full measure, 100%, when His will is perfected in our lives, then we can say we have success. And Joshua was a very successful man. And at the end of his mission, he brings out this tremendous mission statement saying, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." And as we look into the book of Joshua, right at the beginning, when God made a promise to Joshua, we know that Joshua took over after Moses. And Joshua was a man who had seen the different ways in which the Israelites had behaved during their wilderness journey. And Joshua would have wondered, "My Lord, how am I going to lead these lakhs of people? These people who are used to murmuring and grumbling and turning their backs." And it was at that time that God encouraged Joshua in the first chapter of Joshua, verses 5, 6, 8. He says, "No man will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. Be strong and of good courage." And I want to turn your attention this day to the 8th verse in the first chapter of Joshua. "This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success." I want to stress on that word, good success. You will make your way prosperous. You will have good success. Success is what everyone is looking for these days, especially the youngsters. My dear friends, the Lord told Joshua, keep God's law in your mouth. Keep God's law in your mind. And keep God's law in your actions. And then you will have good success. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The world thinks in a different way. When we run with the world, we also think in a different way. Success comes in different ways. But that's not what God told Joshua. He said, let God's law be in your mouth. Let God's law be in your mind. Let God's law be in your action. And then you will have good success. And I want to show you quickly through the life of Joshua, the different challenges that he faced. And during those challenges, it was not anything else that brought Joshua success, but it was the word of God. And whenever Joshua obeyed the word of God, he had great success, grand success. In chapter 3, we read about the first challenge that Joshua faced. He had to cross the river Jordan along with this multitude of Israelites. And Joshua 3:15 says, Jordan overflows its banks all the time of the harvest. At the beginning of the chapter, you will notice that they had encamped beside Jordan for about 3 days. And I think those 3 days, Joshua would have been wondering what to do, how to cope with this matter. How could we cross over this Jordan, which was overflowing its banks? And after 3 days, in the 5th verse, Joshua looks at the people and says, sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders. Sanctify yourself, and tomorrow the Lord will do wonders. Dear brothers and sisters, once, a few years ago, I was ministering in South Africa. And a dear brother of God was driving me on a huge highway in Durban. And as we were going on that highway, he was showing me all the things around. And in my opinion, South Africa is the most beautiful place on the surface of the earth. It is a country with hills and valleys and meadows and springs. It is just simply beautiful. And he, after we were driving a certain distance, he said, do you know where we are driving? Do you know on what we are driving? I said, this seems to be a highway. And then he told me, a huge river was flowing here. It was full of water. But lions used to come down from the mountains and drink water from that river. And the people living around used to get very panicky, very scared at those times. So the government took up a big project whereby they turned the way of the river, the waters of the river, into a different direction, and the whole water was drained from that particular spot into the city, and that dry ground was leveled and this highway was constructed. I was amazed when I heard that, and I thought to myself what technology they would have used and how many crores or millions of dollars would have been spent, how many people would have worked. Maybe some people would have lost their lives also while working on this project. But at the same time, my thought turned to Joshua. Imagine Joshua with these lakhs of people standing on the side of Jordan. And Jordan was overflowing its banks. Where was their technology? Where was their money? And even if they had it, where was the time? Hallelujah. But God gave them a different strategy. Hallelujah. That is how Joshua became so successful. Joshua received orders from God, which were so different from what the world thinks. The Lord said, Joshua, let the people sanctify themselves. Hallelujah. And when they sanctified themselves, the Lord did a great miracle. We know what happened. But I want to show you that even before the miracle happened, even before the waters of Jordan stood still upwards and made way for the people of Israel to cross over, in verse 13, Joshua makes a profound statement. He says, it shall come to pass as soon as the soles of the feet of the priests bearing the ark touch the waters, Jordan, the waters of Jordan will be cut off. Joshua makes a prophetic announcement. You sanctify yourself, and you know what is going to happen? Jordan is going to divide. You know what is going to happen? Even before it happened, even before he saw what was going to happen, he boldly told the people, just sanctify yourselves, and it shall come to pass that the waters of Jordan will stand as a heap upward. Hallelujah. Sanctification, cleansing our lives, is a very powerful experience whereby we can receive the miracle of God in our lives. And as the waters stood as a heap upward, the children of Israel crossed over. And we know that Joshua commanded the people to bring out 12 stones from the river Jordan, so that when the children grew up and asked their parents, what do these stones mean? Joshua tells the families there, when your children ask you, in Joshua chapter 4 verse 22, let your children know that when the children of Israel sanctified themselves, God did a great miracle. Hallelujah. My dear brothers and sisters, let's have experiences of cleansing ourselves on and off. Not only when we go for a communion service, but let there be seasons, let there be times in our lives when we just forget everything, put away everything, and just sit at the feet of the Lord and sanctify ourselves. Lord, see if there is any wicked way in me. Lord, search my heart, know my ways, and see if there is any wicked way in me. When my children were small, I used to do that. I would suddenly call them and exhort them to sanctify themselves. And I would send them to different rooms, and they would return crying, confessing small mistakes, little things that they had done that were wrong in the sight of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Even in my own experience, when I first got saved, before I got saved, there were two illnesses in my body. And medically, I know there is no permanent cure even today for those two illnesses. One was a skin disease. And today, I could not have stood here if that disease had continued in my body. But when I surrendered my body to the Lord, my soul and my spirit, when I asked forgiveness, when I took water baptism after repenting, and I came out of the waters of baptism, till today, those diseases have never touched my body again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That is the power of sanctification. That is the power of sanctification. Joshua received this order for sanctification from the Lord. It was so different from what the world will tell us today. Going on to the next challenge that Joshua faced was against the city of Jericho. I like that verse, Joshua chapter 6, 1, where it says, now Jericho was straightly shut up because of the children of Israel. I hope the slide is on the city of Jericho. It says, because of the children of Israel, Jericho was straightly shut up. Many times, we've just received our promise. We've just received our inheritance. We've just made it. And then a big Jericho wall appears. And the word of God says, just for the sake of the Israelites, the Jericho walls were straightly shut up. Many times, Satan brings a strong opposition because we are children of God. And now, in this occasion, the word of the Lord came to Joshua in a very different way, in a way that we could never imagine. We know that they had to go around the city with the army, with the priests wearing and blowing the ram's horns, and also the priests carrying the ark, and again the army. They had to go around the city 6 days, once every day. And on the seventh day only, they had to go around seven times. And Joshua had given them a commandment saying, in verse 10, he commanded the people, you shall not shout, don't make any noise with your voice, neither shall any word proceed out of your mouth until the day I ask you to shout, and then you shout. And in verse 16, when they were asked to shout, and they made a big loud shout along with the trumpets, the walls of the city fell down. Hallelujah. And the children of Israel took Jericho. Jordan River reminds us of problems that we just cannot cope with. And the Lord said, sanctify yourselves. Whereas the city of Jericho reminds us of problems that come and stand against us when we are close to receiving our inheritance, our blessing. And here we see how in the beginning Joshua says, don't open your mouth, just keep quiet. But later on he says, shout. When I was about to receive my professor title in my medical college, there we have to do research and publish papers in medical journals for us to index medical journals for us to receive our promotion. And when my promotion was due, I had one more paper to write up and to send to a medical journal. And I remember when all the write-up was ready, the manuscript was ready, there was another person working with me who came and picked up the manuscript and said, I just want to go through it and I'll return it. We didn't have a computer at that time in our department. And he took it and he never returned it. And all my data was gone. And many times I requested him, he just said, I don't know where I placed it, and he forgot about it. And I was receiving letters from our director saying, we need your paper to give your promotion. And my heart was filled with a lot of emotions. You know, it was boiling, because when we get promotion, we get a hike in salary also. But then one day, in a dream, my Lord showed me a little lamb. Vai thorakkada aattukutti pola. A lamb that was taken to be slaughtered, and its mouth and hands and legs were tied up. And the Lord said, don't open your mouth, I will fight for you. Hallelujah. When I went back to the department, I could speak to that person with love. I could speak to that person without any hatred or any bitterness in my heart. And what happened was, very quickly, with the help of another friend, I was able to write up another paper and send it to a journal. But usually they take about 3 months, 6 months to send their reply in those days, a few years ago. But to my amazement, they sent a reply very quickly. When our screening meeting, our promotion meeting was going on, even at the last minute, they called me and said, we still haven't received your paper. But exactly on the day when my condition was going to be discussed, the paper arrived. And I was able to show it to them, and the Lord gave me promotion. Hallelujah. Sometimes the Lord says, don't open your mouth, just keep quiet. And there are times after that when the Lord says, shout. Hallelujah. Shout. Praise the Lord. And when we do that, God gives us great success. It is different from what the world will offer. It is different from what the world will say. go to the higher authorities, go to court, fight your case. But here we see Joshua saying, don't open your mouth, just keep quiet, and I will fight for you. The Lord fought for Joshua, and Joshua had great success. The walls of Jericho fell down, and they took the city and burnt the city. And as we go on to the third challenge that Joshua faced, it was against a city called the city of Ai. The city of Ai was a very small city, and having received victory after victory, the people and Joshua thought just a few thousands of people were enough to go for war, and that's what they did. But to their great embarrassment, they were defeated. And we see that in Joshua chapter 7. Joshua rent his clothes in verse 6, and he fell to the earth with dust upon his face and head. And in verses 10 and 11, the Lord looks to Joshua and says, Joshua, why do you lie on your face like this? Israel has sinned. There is something cursed in the camp of Israel. Sanctify the people, find out what cursed thing there is in the camp of Israel and remove it. And then I will fight for you. And we know, as the story goes, they found a man called Achan. And when Achan was examined, Joshua chapter 7 verse 21 says, Achan says, yes, I saw a beautiful, goodly Babylonian garment, 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight. I coveted them, I lusted after them, and now they are hidden the earth in my tent. Achan was stoned to death, and when they went back to war against Ai, God gave Joshua success. Hallelujah. Now what was the commandment that God gave to Joshua? God told Joshua, there is something in your camp that should not be there. It was a beautiful Babylonian garment. 1 John 2:15, 16 and 17 says, love not the world, nor the things of the world. Jesus said, be in the world, but be not of the world. Because all that is in the world is going to pass away. But only those who do the will of God will remain forever. Hallelujah. Love not the world. All around us we have opportunities to love the world, to love the things of the world, to love the ways of the world. But the Bible is so different. The Lord says, don't love the world. Don't love the world. It will become a curse in your tent. It will become a curse in your family. And then he also said he had taken gold and silver. Gold reminds us of the offering, the tithing that we have to give to the Lord. The tithes that we have to give to God. Malachi 3:10 says, bring all your tithes into the storehouse of the Lord. And the verses before that says, will a man rob God, but you have robbed me? And you say, in what have we robbed you? And God says, in your tithe and in your offering. Dear children of God, when Joshua removed those accursed things, there was great success among the Israelites, because God had commanded that the gold and silver in Jericho had to go into the temple of God. Gold and silver had to go into the temple of God. That is why gold reminds us of tithes and silver reminds us of offering. When we see needs in the church, when we see needs in the work of God, in the vineyard of God, God wants us to offer to him. Several years ago, I don't know, some of you may know, my husband passed away 2 years ago. He was on a wheelchair for many years. He underwent a simple tonsillectomy operation for tonsils, and there was an anesthetic problem, and his nervous system was totally damaged. My children were very, very small, and almost all our life he was on a wheelchair. But at that time he lost his job. I had to move from one city to another, so I didn't have a job. And at that time, our church building was going on back home in Vellore. It was a very small shed with thatched roof. It was leaking, and our pastor was trying to renovate it and make it a good, strong building. People were bringing in their offering. There was a great desire in me to offer, but I had no money. My finances were very, very hard at that time. No job for me, no job for my husband. I had got into a small job, but I could not make ends meet. And when this was going on and I saw the need in the church, I said, Lord, I want to give an amount. And I thought of a huge amount that was huge for me at that time. And I said, Lord, I want to give to my church. I want to give this much, but I cannot do it. If you give it to me, I will give it. And that was a time when, even when I gave my offering, I would regularly give my tithes. But sometimes I would even look at the face of the pastors to see if he would help me out. It was so hard for me those days. But as I began to pray, believe me, in just 2 weeks, so many people started sending me money from all over. Friends, relatives, and they said, keep this for the children, use it for the family, use it for your needs. I collected it, and within 2 weeks, I had the amount I wanted to give. I ran to our church. I ran to the pastor and I said, this is for the church. Hallelujah. But today I can tell you, as I stand here, when I have had greater needs for the children, for their education, and for their future, God has given me pressed down, shaken, and overflowing. Hallelujah. God is not a debtor to anyone, but our gold and silver belongs to the Lord. Hallelujah. That is what God taught Joshua in order to be successful. And then we go on to see how five kings joined together, King Adonizedek with four other kings joined together in order to fight against Joshua, because they knew Joshua was very successful. Now when five armies joined together, naturally any man will be fearful. How can I face five armies? But God told Joshua, don't fear, Joshua, I will be with you. No man will be able to stand against you. And as Joshua went for battle, the word of God tells us that they went with their sword. But the verse in Joshua chapter 10 verse 11 says, as they fled from before Israel, God sent great hailstones from heaven, and more people died of the hailstorm than people died of the swords that the children of Israel used. The swords that the children of Israel used were there, but that was not enough. But God sent a hailstorm, and the hailstorm killed more people. Isaiah chapter 22 tells us the hail speaks of the strong and mighty one who is with God. Isaiah chapter 30 and verse 30 also says, God shall cause his glorious voice to be heard. And the last part of the verse says, he will come as a tempest and with hailstones. These hailstones remind us of the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. It reminds us of the anointing of the Holy Spirit. The anointing of the Holy Spirit is so powerful that the anointing can break every yoke of bondage in our lives. The anointing can break anything in our lives. And the anointing can do more than what we can do with our own strength. Hallelujah. The five kings remind us of problems, of temptations that come through our five senses. Our five senses. Every day we see temptations coming through our five senses. And many times, as children of God, we have to battle against them. And many times we fail. How can we have success? Is it by reading books? Is it by meditation? What is the real way by which we can overcome the battles that come through our five senses? I remember when I was very young, 17, 18, 19. Sometimes I would spend whole nights in the presence of God, asking God to give me victory in my life. Hallelujah. Because when the anointing of God comes, it comes as a hailstone and it topples down everything that is against us. And finally, Joshua, we see, waged long time war with all the kings. Joshua chapter 11 verse 18, Joshua made war a long time. In this world, Jesus said, you have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Many of us today have long wars in our lives. Sometimes the problem goes on and on and on. But the Lord told Joshua, I will give you the whole land and you will divide it as an inheritance to the children of Israel. Joshua 23:14 says, not one thing failed of all the good things which the Lord God spoke concerning you. All came to pass. Not one thing failed. Hallelujah. This morning also, shall we just close our eyes for a few minutes? Perhaps you are also going through a long war, but God says it is only when we wage war that God can give us our inheritance. Many children of God are good believers, But are we good fighters? We need to fight till we receive our inheritance. When the ways of a man please God, even enemies will become peaceful with us. Shall we just close our eyes and commit our lives to the Lord? Dear brothers and sisters, is there a problem like Jordan? Too hard, too big for you to cope with? The Lord says, sanctify yourselves. Is there a wall of Jericho? You're so close to your blessing, but there is a huge wall standing against you. The Lord says, just keep quiet. And when I tell you, shout, praise the Lord, and the walls will fall down. Is there a small problem like the city of Ai? It is small, but it tags on to your life. It goes on and on and on. The Lord says, examine yourself. If there are pleasures of the world, Babylonian garments, throw it away. If there is gold and silver in your tent, bring it to the house of the Lord. Are there five kings battling against you? Five senses battling against you? Give room to the anointing, and the anointing of the Holy Spirit will break every yoke. Are there problems, wars going on? Don't give up. The Lord says, it is only when you fight, you will receive your inheritance. Hallelujah. Shall we close our eyes?